you know, I want to learn Deliverance. Can I come up there and learn it? And he said, how about getting a hold of these people and seeing if they'll come down? And Mike Smith here, he has hardcore Christianity ministries, graciously came down for free, and his whole team. Deliverance and to do some deliverance. So,
right.
Because, you know, in the Bible it talks about how it says, first get the log out of your own eye, and then, you know, get the splinter out of others. And the church hasn't even been addressing that Christians can have demons, you know? So, anyway, so yeah, Mike, hardcore ministries, he has a prison ministry, he's on the radio, he also has a healing and deliverance classes that he does up in Phoenix.
Amen.
And all of you are here because God is telling us it's time to set the captives free.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Look around Tucson. We see it. We know. So, oh, by the way, today, I got something saying that they're trying to demolish Miracle Valley.
Yes.
In Sierra Vista. So, yeah, we all need to say no to that, you know?
I'm sorry, what is Miracle Valley?
It is a place where Aon had a Bible school, lots of miracles happened. It was built in, I think, the 50s.
Oh, okay. I never heard of it.
Yes, it's a great, great place.
Yeah.
Just look at it, but you'll get all kinds of information.
Yeah, chair.
They got them.
And,
they got them.
So I know that the time is now for this. I myself was delivered with no withdrawals. I had back surgery. I had a terrible pain, opiate pain med, and benzo addiction, and I was delivered in one day, no withdrawals. I don't go to meetings. Done. People I know in my little circle who should be here and are, I don't know if I'm running late, same thing happened to them. So not only is this possible, God's releasing it right now to the church.
Yeah, that's right.
So we're going to start praying for people. All of our family who are addicts, we all have them.
Yes.
Come on, tell the truth.
Yes, and they're out there. I mean, it's sad, but the young people who are homeless on the streets here. So we're going to start praying for them. They're going to get delivered.
Yes.
It's not, you have to go to AA and NA. No.
That's right.
Then we have to disciple them.
Yes.
It's extremely important that these people get hooked up with churches.
Right.
And people who can teach them. Mm-hmm. And then they go get more. You know, they learn deliverance, right? Anyway, so Mike Smith, Hardcore Ministries, please welcome him. And his team.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
I've been trying to crack the Tucson market for about 15 years, and I haven't been doing too well. I was hoping that she is my ticket. So thank you for showing up. This is great. We've been down here half dozen times or so over the years, but we really want to set up shop down here is what I'm looking to do. So I hope that this is some kind of a beginning today. That would be great. Phoenix has gone to the dogs. The devil's taken over the whole country. And I don't know what it's like down here, but it's probably something similar. Sin's running amok. And a movie just came out. Anybody see it? Come Out in Jesus' Name. Anybody see that movie? Yeah. That thing swept the country. And the great thing about that movie was there were so many people manifesting in the theater all over the country that I think it was the good Lord trying to tell people, hey, this is a real world. There's a real spirit world. It's not just something in the movies. This is really happening. And the devil's really taking over the churches and the communities. And somebody's got to step up and stop it. And that somebody would be you.
Yes. Amen.
Somebody's got to step up and stop it. And that person is you. And that's why I came down here. I want you to save Tucson. Because that's God's will.
Amen.
All right. We have a lot of people come up to see us from Tucson. We have a counseling ministry there, and you can come up for, if you're a born-again Christian, there's no charge for the counseling services. You can just call me and make an appointment, and I'll put you on the schedule. I usually put you on about 1 o'clock if you're coming up from Tucson, so you can miss the traffic in the morning, and then when you go home, you miss it in the afternoon. If you come up early or you go home late, it gets a little nasty on the 10. So you're welcome to do that. There's no charge for the services. You can come up for a private deliverance session. We get a lot of people from Tucson coming up. But I'm trying to develop a home base here. Yeah.
Do you do children?
Children, yeah. Every other month, we have a deliverance service for children. It's on Saturday at 10 o'clock. The next one is May 6th. Preteens. If you know somebody who has preteens, we have a whole service Saturday for them. And kids are usually pretty easy to get delivered. We do ask for permission to pray for them, because the parents or the guardian or whoever it is in charge of the kids, not us. So if you want to bring a child to the services, don't drive by a daycare or something and kidnap a kid. We need somebody to bring the child that's either the parent or the guardian or somebody has authority over the child to give us permission to pray for the child, okay? Could be a grandparent, anything like that. But then after that, kids are easy to get delivered. They don't have all the rotten baggage of an adult.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, the kids don't get demons because they're sinning. Kids don't sin. They transfer in from the infected parents or the grandparents or something like that. So we try to get the parents delivered along with the kids, if possible, at that service, because the kids didn't pick up the demons from on their own. They were funneled in through the family tree. And the demons like kids more than anybody because they're easy to control. They're easy to infect. Kids are sitting ducks when the parents are not spiritually responsible. So the devil loves kids. And as you can tell, he's sweeping the country. Antifa, Black Lives Matter, and all that. They are now kids who are grown, who never got any discipline. Instead of a whipping, they got a timeout. And their parents were chucked full of demons. Now they're chucked full of demons. And the next generation coming is going to leave everybody in a state of shock. State of shock. The immediate shock is going to be the satanic transgender movement. These demons are extremely violent and angry. And they are going to cause a lot of pain. Anyway, the Holy Ghost knows all about that. And there's revivals breaking out thither and hither around the country. Colleges. That movie. So the Spirit of God's not going to sit there and just take this. He's going to make a stand. And that stand includes you. That would be you.
Amen.
America's going to hell in a handbasket because of what? Politicians, Satan, fallen angels. No. All the guilt lies at the foot of the church. The church failed the Great Commission, and the devil swept through. Jesus told us exactly what to do, and the churches said, we're not doing it. Mark 16, Matthew 28, Luke 23 specifically lays out the Great Commission. Here's what I want you to do. I'm going back to heaven. I'm leaving you in charge. I want you to do this. That's what it said. Correct? Matthew 28, Mark 16. These signs shall follow those who believe. The churches said, no, we're not doing that. The lady that set this up, she seems like a nice person. She contacted me. Who was the other person I contacted?
Laura.
Oh, Laura, okay. These two contacted me. And they said, well, we want to get Deliverance going in Tucson. We're going to contact some churches and get some people over there. And I didn't say anything because I didn't want to rain on their parade. I didn't tell them that that's not going to work. And they contacted me a week later. You know, this is not working. Every church we talk to doesn't want to do it. Right? And it's pure human nature, okay? I'm kind of an expert on human nature. I've been a counselor for over 40 years. I came out of the psychology and counseling field, so people have always been my business. Human beings don't like things that are confusing by nature. They feel uncomfortable around what they don't understand. And Deliverance isn't like the rest of the gospel, even healing. It's completely different. It's weird. And the reason for it is demons do not mind. So they don't act polite. They don't behave sometimes. The reaction of a spirit in somebody's body is kind of creepy at times, or it feels odd. People don't, by nature, don't like chaos. You know, they like this, where everybody's sitting nicely and quietly listening to somebody talk. This is what they like. They don't like bizarre activity by nature. And so the churches threw out Deliverance decades ago because of that reason. It's confusing. The people come to the pastor and they say, hey, why did that person, why were they spitting out? Why did this person start screaming? And they feel uncomfortable. So if a person in church feels uncomfortable to a pastor, that's a red flag that you may be losing a unit of revenue. Mm-hmm. Each person in the church is seen as a unit of revenue, potentially. So if you're uncomfortable with what's going on in your church, you will just simply find another church. If you find another church, your revenue and your contributions to that church transfer to that other church. And if you're a pastor and you have to earn a living, you want the person to stay in your church. Correct? So what do we got to do to get you to stay here? Well, if you don't like Deliverance, you got to go, or the Deliverance has got to go. Guess what went?
The Deliverance
went out. That's how it works. It's just human nature. That's the way people are. Some of us don't mind any of that stuff. That would be me. All I care about is somebody getting healed. Amen. What I have to go through to get that is a byproduct to be dismissed. Mm-hmm. Huh? I don't care. But I'm a counselor, not a pastor, so you can see the dilemma here. Yeah, pastors are by and large good people. They're usually intelligent. They're caring people. But they, like other people, don't like boats rocked. And they don't like chaos. They don't like confusion. And demons, that's their specialty. It's confusion and chaos. They're really good at it. What I wanted to share with you today, we'll see if it works out, were just some basic information about the spirit world. And then I'd like to take some questions. I like small groups like this so people can ask questions. And that's usually, that usually goes pretty good. If you can keep the question short, and if the question is inappropriate or silly, I'll have Kelly monitor that, and then you'll be removed. Yeah.
I have a question. I have two children that don't live here, and they probably don't know they need deliverance, and they might not even agree with it if they were here. Can it be done without them here, and is it advisable to do it without them knowing it and wanting it?
No, it's not. What I do in those cases is I just pray and ask God to, you know, open their eyes or break them or bring them to a point of something. And then I move in with what she's talking about when they're more receptive. Yeah. If you try to cast demons out of somebody that doesn't want them or wants to keep them, that could backfire on you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
You know, I'm so glad that you brought that question out because I have a son. I have four sons, two daughters. But this particular son is really going through something right now and needs deliverance. But what you said, if you have to set, if the stage has to be set for them to want to receive the deliverance, because you made a great point. If they want to keep them, you know, a lot of people, they want to keep their spirits. That's a reality. So you have to just pray that the, like you said, like how you brought up, their eyes being open. Pray for them so that the ground could be ready. God can go ahead and prepare it for when the deliverance takes place, when they're ready.
Right.
If I can speak to that, I have two kids in the same boat. I've been praying for them. My daughter got rescued yesterday. Oh, thank you. Thank God. I know the timing is God. God say, you know what? Enough of this mess, you guys.
You know, but see, it's so good you brought that up because he just got out of incarceration, right? But what the man of God just said about the transgender agenda, satanic agenda, that's what it's trying to attach itself to this one, son. Yes.
Right. Hi, Dan.
Along those same lines, I'm here.
Louder.
Along the same lines, among the deliverance ministers on YouTube and everyone, I'm hearing the word arrest. Can we long distance arrest them, like hold them at bay, so that the person can be put in the right frame of mind to receive it? Not where we're casting them out, but we can, or do we not want to interfere in stuff like that unless we have clear direction from Holy Spirit? And then, quick question, how do we...
No, that's possible.
That is?
Mm-hmm. To just... Yeah, you're just, arresting is another... rephrasing of Matthew 18, whatever you bind.
Okay, so binding is
on earth.
Casting out, right?
Yeah, arresting, I think that's what the term means. I'm guessing. I've never used that before. Yeah.
You know,
yes, sir.
The problem is not the church. The church has been established, okay? It's not the church. The church has been established. It's the leaders. See, the problem is, see, I've been doing deliverance over 7 years. Over 1,000 set free annual. The problem is, it's the leaders. Because why? Because if they start getting into this type of deliverance, what's going to start happening? They're going to start getting attacked. There's going to be spiritual warfare. Their kumbaya, my Lord, you know, thing is going to be disrupted. And they don't want that. They don't want to go into this other realm.
Right.
Because this is a realm where you cannot see.
Right.
But God has given those in the deliverance to be able to see what they look like. It's like me. The Holy Spirit has given me the ability to see what these demons look like, but without losing my mind. Because when I have to do deliverance, I have to see what type of demons they are. You know, what area am I dealing with? And you know, here's my thing, the most important thing, you don't gotta be screaming and yelling and shouting things out. What did Jesus ever once in the Word of God start screaming at them? No, he just spoke with authority. And that's the thing, we do not know our authority.
That's right.
But we are in Christ.
Right.
So we know
right.
that we can be able to be effective.
Right.
I'm trying to remember what I was going to say. Oh, I was going to say the devil doesn't act up as much when we're going along with him until we oppose him. And that's when he acts up.
Yeah.
Because we're going along with
him. All right, I just want to piggyback with Apostle Tillis said. The church is alive and well. We are the body of Christ. The thing is, the church, you know, it's only a remnant that's going to be saved. It's all by our obedience. If we obey, you know, it says when you obey the Lord, you resist the devil and he'll flee from you. If we train up our children in the way that they should go, if we stop doing what the world say and do what God say, we won't have this many problems. You know, deliverance is easy for those who have faith, for those who are walking by faith, for those who are studying to show themselves approved.
Jesus laid hands on people and cast demons out. I know, I've tried it. I need
the scripture says these only come out by fasting and prayer.
Yeah.
We have to fast and pray.
And thank God that we have someone teaching us down here because we need it.
Right. So I just want to encourage you. Will encourage everyone. Nothing can happen without faith in the word of God. Nothing can happen. So if we want to do deliverance, if we want to be used by God, we have to first start in believing in the word of God and then following the example of Jesus and know why we want deliverance to happen. Know why we want these things to happen. Because what does it say in James? Where does wars and things come from among you? Is it your lust? You know, you have and you receive not. I'm paraphrasing because I'm not quoting it exactly because I'm not quoting in the Bible right now. But I just want to encourage you. I've been from LA, I've been through Vegas. This whole Western seaboard is what God has given us for kingdom impacting communities to come out and to impact the communities and to show the love of God. And to
connect
with
Amen. So
other people.
We're going to continue doing this here in Tucson. Maybe we'll get you up in front of a crowd. Yeah. Right now, we got Mike.
Yeah, sounds good. Yeah, what he just described there, what we should be doing, is exactly what the churches are not doing. And that's why I'm down here. What he just said, he was going over basic Christian material. What he just said.
Yes.
That's something every church should all have already got that bagged. That's normal stuff. The fact that not doing that proves my point.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the answer is not to bash the leaders. We just pray for each other.
Well, you got to pray for the leaders to change. And you got to get them to teach deliverance.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
We can blame the churches all we want. But it really boils down to the individual and the relationship you have to Jesus. Fasting and praying is essential.
Mm-hmm.
And following his path, his journey, you do surrender daily. Every day, you have to surrender. Taking our sins to the cross and then praying for it and then taking it back with you, you're still a square one.
Yeah.
It's an everyday surrender.
Right. And what she just said, again, proves my point. If the churches were doing what she said, there wouldn't be any need for me to come down here.
That's right.
Okay? If they were doing what he just said, that's basic Christianity. Truth. Do that. Do this. They're not doing it. So I'm here to try and encourage them to do it without them if you have to.
I'm going to be real quick. I hear a lot, it is not about the church as a whole, but you have to look at the church because you have to look at what is being taught in it. Is the information within the body being conveyed over the way that God wants it done? Is the church, which is God's house, being run the way he wants it to be run, to reach his people, to set the captives free for real? Is it about, because you can look church, You can say, don't look at it, but look at how the church, what the church is doing. Look what's going on in it. Look at more like the world than it is holiness. Too much compromise. A lot of things have been allowed to come within. Now, there are some select ones that are trying their best to do what God has said. But we, as the people of God, the leaders of God, are supposed to go according to His word and His agenda. It is about, that's what He came, bled and died and raised for, so that we would be free. They are Christians that are still bound. They are pressed, depressed, suppressed by demons, and nobody is addressing it. That's why they go to church, they go one way, and they leave the same way. No change. But the revenue is there. There's leaders that are scared to sit certain people down, from the choir to the praise and worship to the intercessors, because they're not walking in full authority. God wants us to walk in the power, in the authority, in the anointing of the Holy Ghost. That is the only thing that the enemy responds to.
That's right.
Not your flesh, not your agenda, not your personal thoughts about it.
She's good. See, only we have God. A ministry well, here in Tucson. We just thought that
would
get together.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I just want to state something, okay? The thing is, I teach and train on the Zoom, okay? And I teach and train in Africa, India, and Pakistan. And the leaders are tired, just like she was saying. They're tired of them coming in the same way out. Now, I have taught and trained these young men and women of God. And they're going out into the local villages, they're going into the jungles, they're going into the street, and all they're doing is they're seeing the power of God being effective, because why? They're hungry to see people get set free, you know? And that's the thing, it starts from the leadership, you know? And you see, here's the thing, okay? Who is the church? Right here. We are the church. We have a choice. You know?
Yeah.
You know, I'll tell you what, I've been kicked out of several churches here in Tucson.
Uh-huh.
Just because the Holy Spirit told me to go cast that thing out. That person's right there right now. You know, they think that it's a Pentecostal thing going on before. They're shaking. No, that's the spirit of Kundalini right there acting up. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But by the time the screaming and all this comes down to, they don't want you there no more. You know? You disrupted
yeah.
them.
Now he just proved everything I just said earlier. Okay. That's the problem. Yeah.
I just have one other question. But why wait for the leaders? Why do we not just rise up as a defense?
Well, that's why we came down here.
We can help those leaders to be delivered.
That's why we're here. I'm not going to the leaders. I'm going to you. That's why I'm here. So everything everybody said just proved everything I just said. And that's why we need deliverance. Because they're not doing that. They're not doing it. How do you know if you need deliverance? Well, demons are like medical conditions. They all have symptoms. So if you have a spirit, you'll have a symptom of some kind. Could be anything. Anger, bitterness, unforgiveness, insomnia, chronic nightmares, repetitive bad dreams. You've got some symptoms. Weird pains in your body, strange illnesses that don't respond to medical care or surgery or anything. Weird. They always cause symptoms. If you're mentally ill, you've got demons in your brain. They cause symptoms. Repetitive bad thoughts, chronic obsessive compulsive thoughts, weird headaches, strange symptoms. Each demons are different. They have different types of skills, and they generate different symptoms. So you can track them through their symptoms. You don't have to have the names of all of them. You just, hey, you got an anger, there's an anger spirit. Hey, that's good enough. You use your faith, boom. Demons always have symptoms. You know, they're the polar opposite of the fruit of the spirit. The Holy Ghost is here, they're here. There's symptoms to it. Right? Symptoms, alcoholism, drug addiction, food addictions, porn addictions, what have you, yeah.
The controlling spirit that you see in a lot of people where they need to control other people, is there a specific
yeah, no.
thing that's connected with that?
There is, yeah. Normally, people that are controllers usually have fear spirits. It's deep-seated insecurity, and they are chronically afraid and have anxiety. So in their mind, if I can control you and your behavior and your thoughts and what you think, and that's going to protect me. It's a false belief system, but usually it's deep-seated insecurity.
What about the Jezebel spirit?
The same thing. That's a rebellion demon.
Right.
You know,
Jezebel.
You
yeah.
know, but here's my thing, okay? Here's my thing. You got to have discernment because not everything is demonic.
Right.
You got to know when it's demonic and when it's broken to be able to do inner healing.
Yeah.
Now, like me, for example, I went to Benson and they asked me to come there. I never done it in my life. But I dealt with someone that had multiple personalities.
Uh-huh.
That I asked the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, is this demonic? Holy Spirit said, no, it's brokenness. A lot of trauma. A lot of trauma. What the Holy Spirit did in 3 months, a psychiatrist was trying to do in 20 years. You know, but God dealt with each personality and the pain of it, and bam, that person got back its mind. And that's the thing about it. So many times we're busy, we want to cast out a devil. That it's not even a devil. It could be brokenness. There could be something. I mean, right, there's a trauma, you know. There's anxiety. There's fear. I mean,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
I've been here doing a ministry for 7 years, and most of the people that I run into in food ministry and whatever that we connect with that have addictive spirits, there's usually some sexual abuse somewhere, mm-hmm. some kind of trauma like that, mm-hmm. or it's in the family, it's mm-hmm. a cursed family or whatever, but mm-hmm. that seems to be mm-hmm. a real link to what the addiction comes
mm-hmm.
in.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I was thinking about what he said about the multiple personalities,
uh-huh.
and is it a demon or is it a personality? Or is it
it's a mix.
Problem? What I'm saying is, when we have fasting and praying, and we have the Spirit of God aligned with the Word of God, we'll have the discernment to know that we won't go casting it out and yelling and screaming, but we'll know how to deal with that.
Yeah, and the same thing with discernment. Some things are a medical condition, and it's not demons. So the person needs medical care, not deliverance. And that's your job. That's when you come in to help people. You're the minister, and you have to weed that out for them. Does this person need surgery, or do they need healing, or do they need deliverance? What do they need? That's your job.
Their medical condition can be cured through prayer.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Jesus heals all conditions.
We're watching a lot of miracles.
Would that be, because you brought up a good point, would that be, it's a two-part, A and B, would it be the spirit of infirmity that you'll be praying in regards to the person is ill, if they need surgery or not, or maybe a spirit of infirmity has attached itself to the individual, or you just go straight on and pray for the healing in that area? You know, I hope I'm saying my question right.
Yeah. Well, what you're saying is not everything's demonic. Okay, so if I decide to sit on the table here and I miss it and I hit my head, that's probably not demonic. It's probably because I'm clumsy. Okay. But if you have strange chronic migraines that manifest around certain types of people and it doesn't manifest around other types, that's probably a spirit in your brain. So you got to use your discernment to figure out, you know, does this person need prayer for healing or they need deliverance? Yeah. Yeah, that's very common.
Thank you.
Yeah, not everything is demons, yeah.
Sometimes the prayer leads them to the doctor that they need, and the doctor does God's work. But, you know, it's just, the prayer is all about the healing, you know. And I think we've seen a real power in when we use God's promise that we stand in agreement with a group of people about a certain thing. We've seen miracles start manifesting.
Yeah, of course.
A girl not that long ago in Phoenix who needed a liver transplant. And I think we might have prayed over it for maybe a month, and the doctor wrote miracle on her chart. She no longer needs one. I mean, it is real.
Yeah, of course. Yes. Yeah, of course it's real.
Stand on his promises.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
That is so true. I had air in my liver. My liver was expanded about 6 months. They expanded the thickness of the brain. Mm-hmm. And they didn't know where the air in my liver came from. And 12 trauma doctors stood around my bed, and I said, "It's like, what happened?" I said, "I don't know, but I know I'm not about to die in the table, because the guy I was serving and healed came out of surgery." They said, "Every test that we took, there's nothing in your body."
Yeah, now that proves exactly what I just said. Some things are demonic, some things are not. Yeah. So if you try to cast spirits out of somebody that doesn't have them, that's going to be a bad afternoon. But if they do have them and you're praying and fasting, that's going to be another bad afternoon.
That's true.
You got to be able to go with the flow. Correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Correct.
All right. Yeah.
I'm so sorry. I can barely hear you.
Oh, okay. This any better?
I'm sorry.
Yeah. This better?
Do you want to move up front of our seats?
Yeah.
There's plenty of seats
right
here. I can't hear.
The closer, the better.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll try and talk louder. All right. Okay. We have a monthly seminar up there. The next one's April 28th on autonomic processing. If you'd like to catch any of our teachings, you can go to our YouTube channel, youtube.com/houseofhealingaz. I got 400 and something teachings on there. I have a special list that I created years ago for certain types of Christians. And it's in different languages. If you send me an email at mike@hardcorechristianity.com, I'll send you this list. It's a step-by-step guide on how to take the person through healing and deliverance. It works 100% of the time. The problem is I can only get about 10% of the people to do it. But I'll send it out to you immediately if you send me an email. No problemo. I have a deliverance training course you can pick up on the website, 18 classes. Thursday nights, we have a healing and deliverance service with Brother Rick and the ministry team at 7 o'clock in Phoenix. That's a donation button on the website. I have a deliverance training class once a month on Saturday, the fourth Saturday of the month at noon. We have a women's spiritual healing and deliverance class every Tuesday night at 6:30 at the Deliverance Center. Sister Julie does that one. We have a Zoom deliverance meeting every Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. If you send me an email, I'll send you the link and the password. That's a nice referral source there. It's easy to refer somebody to a Zoom broadcast. We get dozens of people delivered every week on the Zoom. Wednesday nights, 6 o'clock. I'm not sure if my radio program comes down here. I've been on the radio for over 20 years. I'm on at 7:30 in the morning. I've heard it down here, but not every day. I think the atmosphere has to be right or something. It's on 10 a.m. or something. I'm also on at 7:15 at night. Skip that one. I wrote 3 books, one on mental illness, one on healing, and the other one on Satan. I have a Sunday morning podcast at 9 o'clock. If you'd like to chit-chat, twitch.tv, and then put in HCCADC, and you're there, 9 o'clock Sunday mornings. And all of our teachings are all on different platforms. They're also rebroadcast on these platforms. And today's teaching is the spirit world, basic training. Human beings by nature don't like to get involved in something they don't understand. It's human nature. They'll shun it. Okay? So my idea was, why not break down this system like a second grader? And it kind of works. Here's your goal. This is the purpose of your ministry, is to transfer people from the power of darkness to the kingdom of light. That's your job. And the Apostle Paul outlined in detail the spirit world. And he mentions it several times. For example, this is where all of us used to be, following the archon, the ruler, and the authority, exousia, of the air. What he's saying there is, spirit beings ambulate through the atmosphere. They don't walk around like we do. They transition through the air. Right? And in Ephesians 6, Paul outlines it again. We do not wrestle against archon rulers, spiritual rulers, and spiritual authorities, exousia. We wrestle against the rulers of the darkness of this world. Kosmokrator in Greek means spiritual world rulers. What Paul's saying here is that the spirit world is set up just like a business. It has a hierarchy. In a business, you have the CEO, the CFO, the CEO, and all the rest of them, all the way down to the janitor. In the spirit world, it's built exactly the same way. Satan's the CEO. You got fallen angels, you got different demons, all of them are in a hierarchy. And Paul illustrated it for us in these verses, in Ephesians and in Colossians. In the spirit world, Paul's saying there are thrones or seats of authority, there are lordships, kyriotis, and there are rulers, archon, and authorities, exousia, in the spirit world. It's like a business. And here's how it works. All the spirit beings operate beneath the ozone. If you go to Jupiter, you're not going to get a lot of demons over there. They hang around in the atmosphere where we live. They're in this room right now listening to me talk to you.
It's where they're praying.
They're watching us, and each person is stalked. You have a guardian angel following you around all the time. If you're a born-again Christian, you have a bunch of demons following you around, looking to take you out. And it all happens here in the atmosphere. And I put this little chart together. I blended all those verses together so you can see the hierarchy of what you're facing every day of your life. This is what we cannot see. It's in a hierarchy from him at the top on down through here. Daimonion and daimon are Greek words for run-of-the-mill spirits. Okay? So theoretically, a person that gets involved in hardcore, heavy-duty sin ends up being infected with more powerful demons. your grandmother, who said a couple of curse words and knitted a lot, probably wasn't loaded with demons. If your grandma had demons, they probably were weaker ones. If you had somebody who got involved in New Age, witchcraft, sorcery, very bad. They got more powerful demons. And they're in bigger trouble. The law of sowing and reaping applies in the spirit world. It applies in the natural world. Whatever a man sows, that is what he also reaps. The bigger and more sin you get involved in, the worse and more dangerous demons you attract. If you had committed adultery with your boyfriend twice and then you got married, you were married for 40 years, he died, you are probably not loaded with lust demons. If you were a hoe or a player and you were doing everything you got your hands on, you picked up transfer spirits, you can't believe you got some serious lust problems. Whatever a man sows, that's what he also reaps. The more sin you sow, the worse sin you sow, the worst spirits you get.
You know, one thing I've learned in life is when doing deliverance, we have to be careful of what type of people that we're doing it. Because I found out that there's people that say that they're Christian. You know, sometimes it's discernment. If you're out of discernment, what basically happens is these people get deliverance, but they're Satanists and witches. So what happens? 7-8 times more come, you know, say 7 + 1. So what do? They go to another minister. They get deliverance again.
Right.
Because what happens? They get cast out, so more demons come in. This is how they get power.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they keep adding.
Yeah.
And that's one thing where we have to watch and be careful, but that's discernment right there.
Yeah. Now, he brought up an interesting point. There's a deliverance revival going on in the United States now. Everybody's into deliverance. It's the flavor of the month. The problem is most of these deliverance ministries are going to end up hurting people more than they are helping them. And the reason for that is don't ever get involved in a deliverance ministry that isn't repentance-based. If it's not repentance-based, you're going to end up sicker than you ever were before. Okay, so if I go out to a park and blow a bunch of demons out of you two, and I don't get you to repent, and you don't renew your mind, what I've actually done was damage those two people, and I went out there with a good heart, and I was trying to help them.
Come on,
see? So now, with all the deliverance going on, it's like a big splash. You know, at the public pool, you always had the fat kid on the high board, and it was fun to watch. Boom! It was a massive splash, and it was a great laugh. But the problem is, as he said, if you don't teach repentance and mind renewal, these spirits are going to come back and get back into the person. They won't be able to defend themselves. See? So I never recommend going through deliverance. And that's why I did that miracle list I mentioned, that you go through that list. You have to repent of your sins. You have to renew your mind, because if they get back in, you're going to end up sicker than you were before you came to me. And that's not my hope. My hope is I want you helped and healed, not hurt more. See that? So the TV, YouTube people are blowing demons out of everybody, shopping malls, parks. Okay, that's fine. But if you're not preaching repentance, with it. And you're not explaining that you have to renew your mind on God's word and you have to change your attitude and your behavior, or you're just going to let them all back in. You're actually hurting that person in the long run. They might have some temporary relief, but you're going to end up hurting them down the road. Yeah.
This is why the scripture is saying, all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct the path. We're not our own free agents. Just because we love God, we don't just go blasting demons out. We follow the word of God. Remember,
Holy Spirit.
Right. Teaches us. Right. He shows us who to talk to. Yeah. He shows us who to, you know, we're not free agents. So we ask the Lord, do I overtake that person? Do I talk to that person? Do I cast out this demon? What do you want me to do? Mm-hmm. So.
Right.
I just have a question. So you described the hierarchy, right? So as I know that we have all power over all the enemy, but different people have different, in the spirit, Christians, right?
Okay.
They have different.
Okay, hold on a second. She just made an inaccurate statement. Okay? She's quoting out of Luke 10. And she said we have all authority over the enemy and so on. We do not. Okay? That verse is taken out of context. Okay? I do not have authority to cast demons out of her if she wants to keep her demons.
That's the truth.
I do not have authority to do that. Okay. I don't have authority to go over here of these spirits up here ruling Tucson and tell them to go to Bisbee where they belong. I do not have authority to do that. Okay. If somebody from Bisbee comes here and says, hey, would you help me get delivered? Bang, right on the money. You have authority, as she said, over that situation, but she cannot drive the Bisbee and drive the demons to Sierra Vista. If you do that, you're going to end up sick and destroyed because they will come after you. You stepped out of bounds and they're going to throw a flag on you. Okay? You do not cast demons out of people who want demons. See? I don't go to a palm reader and say, hey, you want to get, no, I like, oh, nope, I'm casting demons. That'll backfire on you, okay? You don't have that authority to do that. Yeah.
And as far as, like, talking to the person before to make sure that they really want that deliverance, part of that, I heard people say, ask the demons, do you have an authority to be there? And that reveals that there's an open door of sin, correct?
Yeah. I wouldn't do that. That's a waste of time. Now look,
okay.
The key to it is your free will. That's what God goes by.
Okay.
If you've got demonic symptoms and you want to be free and you want to get saved, no one's going to force you to get saved, including God.
Okay. Amen.
Okay, that's a free will venture. Right?
Right.
No one's going to force you to get healed. Okay? I've met many people over the years who don't want to get healed, who have secondary benefits from being sick.
Right.
I don't want to go through that.
Right.
But the point I'm making is God goes by your free will.
That's right.
And if your free will is to be healed and delivered, he's already made provisions for that through the cross and the blood, right?
True, yes.
Yeah.
I heard Dad Hagen on TV years ago, and he was in a revival, and he was walking through the corridor when he was finished, and a man, demonic man, I heard Dad Hagen say this, a demonic man said, oh, you can't cast the devil out of me. And so Dad Hagen says, oh, when you're ready to get the devil cast out of you, let me know and I'll cast him out.
Well, he just reworded what I just said.
Right.
Okay, Hagen knew all about that.
Right.
Okay,
right.
So he said what he was saying.
Adding credence to what you were saying.
Yeah, so what he was saying to that guy was, mm-hmm. when you want the demon out,
yes.
I'll cast him out. And Hagen would have blown a demon out of a guy in 2 seconds.
Right.
But he would not have attempted to do that.
Against his will.
Against the person's will, okay? Yeah.
So
How do you know, though, if it's the person speaking or if it's the demon speaking trying to dissuade you?
Okay, that's a long Bible study, but patients that are SMIs or mentally ill, it's touchy. Okay, because their minds are so programmed with demonic thought patterns that it's sometimes very difficult to figure out who's talking to you. Okay, but if a person's not mentally ill and you notice a subtle change in personality type, that's a red flag. There's somebody else talking to you. Okay? Have you ever been around somebody who suddenly lost their temper? And they actually almost sound like a different person and their eyes change. And so, well, that's the spirit coming up in the person. In the same way Peter said to Jesus, no, you cannot go to the cross. You can't leave us. Satan clicked his personality. It flipped. And the devil was talking to Jesus. And so Jesus, with discernment running at the maximum level, saw it was Satan talking to him through Peter. And then he addressed Satan, not Peter. See? So the short answer is, it's you need experience, and it's complicated at times.
Thanks.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I've seen people try to go get personality disorders. And you know, I truly believe that just like, you know,
guys.
Satan had a large satanic army. And, you know, God has his army.
It's right here.
Yeah. But the thing is, we don't go against something unless we're. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, you don't.
If God doesn't.
These.
Say, I want you to go up against these principalities and power.
Yeah.
Because many people do, they go up against
them. No, don't do that.
And then they end up getting whooped.
Don't do that.
Yeah.
Don't do that.
You know? And they're trying to wonder, why? You know, what happened here? Did God command you? They were commander in chief to tell you what to do.
Yeah.
We need to know when to go.
Yes, that's true. But remember, God's not going to tell you to go up here and go get these fallen angels.
Yeah.
That's not going to happen. The Holy Ghost takes care of that for you. You're worrying about the spirits here. That's your business.
What are the spirits that are here?
Everybody, whatever it is, anger, lust, bitterness, whatever the demons are.
These spirits have to come from somewhere. A lot of people believe the disembodiment of the Nephilim.
No, don't worry about Nephilim. You don't need to get involved in that.
Yeah.
The idea is you want to get that spirit out of that person so they can be free. If you'll just focus on that and skip the Nephilim and then skip the demons running San Francisco, you're going to be way ahead of the game. Okay? Jesus never attacked these demons. Neither did Peter or Paul. He whipped the stuffing out of these.
So those spirits that are in the atmosphere that are floating around and in the air are not those.
No, they're down here.
That's see, where is that?
Is that where the angels are then?
No, they're all in the previous slide here. They're somewhere in this section in the Earth's atmosphere, okay? I'm just talking about what you're going to face in Tucson. This down here is all you need to worry about, setting these people free. Okay, what the fallen angels are doing in New Jersey is none of your business. Don't get involved in that because they'll retaliate. I have had people in my office, dozens of them over the years, in tears because they did territorial warfare trying to tear spirits out of Pennsylvania. Praying for the country is different than casting out spirits over New Jersey.
Okay, so like you can't really go after transgenderism.
No.
You can't go after these agendas that are all...
No. The transgender person there, that's a different story. The demons running transgenderism in the United States You cannot cast those out.
Okay.
They're up here. If you try to cast them out, you will regret it.
So that's all in going to knowing about when it talks about it within Ephesians, like the weapons of a warfare and a carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. So you
right
gotta
here.
Know, you gotta know, that's the you gotta know the how to fight the war. You gotta know what war you're in, how to fight, what God has called you to, how to intercede and stay within what the Holy Spirit tells you to do as you're standing in the gap for the boundaries, because that's why I gotta go back with the apostle. I think someone said earlier that I think maybe they had him as well, that the there was a pastor, I knew a pastor, that did not want to cast out demons because of the retaliation. So he said he was no longer going to cast out demons in his church, only his elders were, because he was sick of going home having to deal with the backlash.
Okay, well, there's always a kooky pastor out there. She just outlined a nut. Don't listen to those people. There's no reason to listen. Let's just go with God's word. And let's help these people get free down here. Okay.
The more of us who get free, and the more we free people, the stronger our army gets.
Okay. So, a Native American comes to you and needs deliverance. Well, what's going on there? Well, it's obvious. There's witchcraft there. There's addiction demons. There's rejection spirits. There's fear spirits. They got a whole packet of them, right? I'm not going to do anything about the demons running the Navajos in Arizona up here. I'm not that stupid. I'm going to get this guy to repent and turn his life over to Christ and turn his mind and heart to God's word. And I'm going to get him to repent of his sin and get those Native American spirits out of there. You with me?
Mm-hmm.
See the break? Jesus never did that. Did he? Okay, if you look at the context of Luke 10, what she quoted earlier, it's not in there. You can create any doctrine you want to easily by taking scripture out of context. It's easy to do. Cults do it all the time. Okay? That is a sin. You do not take scripture out of context and throw it at somebody like a mud ball. Everything's written in the text, if you follow me. The text of that verse was not this, it was this. See, they came back, they were overjoyed. They said, Lord, even the spirits are subject to us through your name. And Jesus took them off that focus and said, now look, this is a big splash and you're having lots of fun casting out demons, and we're doing it right now in America. Oh, we got a movie out, we got everything. No, that's not. Focus on the joy of the Lord that your names are written in glory.
Yes.
And there'll always be another healing and another deliverance, but there won't be another name written in glory. You're the only one there. It's just you. See, so he told them, don't emphasis on the manifestations and that, focus on that. He was trying to get their head out of the cloud, so to speak.
I wonder why people, I understand that the exousia is in the demonic realm.
That's the Greek word for authority.
Right, but some people use it as the authority of God also.
Yeah, it's the same Greek word.
Okay.
Same Greek word.
It's in your lineage, in your...
Yeah, this is a demonic lineage, Satan's kingdom. But that's a... Yeah.
Right.
It's like English. You use English in one context and in another, different words.
Thank you.
I
just want to understand completely the difference between binding and loosing. We can bind and loosen, or we can bind spirits that are affecting our world in prayer, but not out there in the physical aspect. Okay. I just wanted to get that clear in my mind.
Anybody mad at me right now?
No.
Scorpions, right? That's what we have. They're on the ground.
They're scorpions.
Right? That's a perfect thing.
Well, they're on the ground. Did you hear what you said?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. You're teaching next time I come down. Any more questions on this chart? Satan has a very organized, well-managed kingdom. He's the boss. He's a narcissist. He's a control freak. I want it done my way, or you're getting the highway. That's how he is. Okay, the Holy Ghost is not like that. He only works with volunteers. I have all these blessings for you and all these miracles, but you're not going to get any of them unless you volunteer and sign up. The devil will draft you into a nightmare and beat you and pound you into submission.
Jesus. Okay, I'm wondering, the Bible says that God, let's get this right, that God flies, or not flies, on the throne angel.
He what?
On the throne angel. God rides on the throne angel. He rides on the wind. Okay. Now, why would the Lord have those thrones, angels that fall down with the Lucifer and the Curitos angels? Why would, I can't pronounce it. Why did they fall down here in the earth realm, in the second heaven?
Okay. Number one, she's asking about fallen angels, or weren't you?
Yeah.
Okay. Really, I don't want to sound rude, but this is none of our business. I don't know why Satan fell. I don't know why the angels believed what he said. It doesn't make any sense to me. I don't know anything about that, and I don't give a rat's fanny what happened. All I care about is getting this person delivered and healed and getting them to repent of their sin and renew their mind and get a blessing from God. What the fallen angels are doing, as far as I'm concerned, they can find a pole and then sit on it. I'm not interested. I'm not interested. Okay? It's none of my business. It's none of my business. I don't know everything, and I'm never going to know everything. That's not my job. Right?
Thank you.
A Tucson needs to be saved. That's all I care about. I don't care what they're doing or why they're doing it. Okay, sorry about that. Now I do have people mad at me, but that happens. That's how it works. Yeah.
Okay, because in our city we three gather weekly to pray for our city.
Hmm? We're out of Benson.
Oh, you're in Benson.
Yes.
Oh, good.
So we pray over our city.
Yes.
What's wrong with that?
No, nothing.
Oh, okay.
But we. What authority, I guess, to
the first one?
Do we have? Where do we need to stop, or what do?
Are you trying to cast the demons out of Benson?
No.
Okay, well, you're doing fine. You're praying for Benson. Good. Keep that up. You're doing a good job.
Do place the angels around, and then.
No, you can't place angels anywhere. You just pray for Benson, and you're going to win. I don't have any authority to boss angels around, okay? Well, Brother Mike's not very spiritual. Listen, the apostles, Jesus, never went around commanding angels to fix them meals and do... What? Forget it. What do I need an angel for? I got the Holy Ghost. I've got the Holy Ghost. I'm not going to drop down to some angel. Forget about it. I'm not interested. When you're at the top, stay there. Why command angels to do this and that? Stop!
Amen.
I would rather you renew your mind and repent of your sin, mm-hmm, as opposed to bossing angels around.
Right, and then praying.
See? Have you ever noticed people that talk about angels and spiritual stuff all the time have wrecked personal lives?
Yes.
You ever notice that? You know why that is? Those are religious demons. They get in their head and they talk about religious things day and night.
All the time.
As my granddad said, they're what?
Wow.
They're so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good.
Yeah, that's good.
Right? What we need to do is just look at the four gospels and follow that pattern.
Amen.
It's a winning system.
Amen.
We can't lose.
Amen. Cool.
So someone walks up to you and they say, I need deliverance. Help me.
Good.
What happens? What's 1, 2, 3?
You have authority over that situation because they came to you and asked for help. Could be anything, not just demons, healing, pray for finances, whatever you want to pray, whatever their needs are. All the needs are met by the Holy Ghost, right? Every need. Yeah, but if they come to you and say, will you come to my city and cast the demons out of my town and go to the mayor and cast the demon out of him, he's an idiot. You stay right here. You're not going there and doing that because you're going to end up sick. You don't have the authority to cast demons out of the mayor of Bisbee.
How would you handle it? I had this woman one time. I was praying for her, and she started taking over the prayer, like helping me. And she went back to her womb, and she was like telling me about spirits that she can see that are coming into her.
Yeah.
That's like a whole different.
No, those are familiar spirits. They were hijacking your deliverance. They took it over. That happens all the time. They'll talk right out of somebody's mouth. That's very common.
Just like.
What do you bat, pull out,
okay.
You drop it.
That's what I did.
No, that person needs to repent. Familiar spirits are the worst demons because they have all these magical powers and they have huge intellects. They run all the world's religions, okay? You got to be a beyond supernatural genius to have come up with Hinduism or Buddhism or Scientology. That would require an enormous level of intelligence, okay? Familiar spirits are the ones that run all the churches. I mean, what she said, they're not doing it. Why don't you think they're doing it? Because familiar spirits keep them from doing it.
Mm-hmm.
They stop it. They block it. And like he said, there's only a remnant running around looking to do the right thing, and thank God I'm standing here in the midst of one. I came down to Tucson, right? And there's a remnant here of people that want to do the right thing. That's why I came down here. I didn't come down here to cast demons out of the Air Force base over here. I'm not interested. I don't have any authority to cast demons out of planes. Don't ask me. All right.
Okay, one last question.
Yeah. Well, you can ask a question.
No, I'm getting up. Typing since 1 o'clock. I'm sleepy.
Really? Oh, you're sleepy.
No, but you're wonderful. I'm not saying that.
Now that's not a demon. She's sleepy. She stayed up too late.
Yeah.
See my discernment? Preach.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. Now we know that Paul went all over his territories that God sent him. Apostle Paul. Okay. And he casts out demons.
Routinely.
Okay, so God does use people to go to different areas.
Why, sure, that's what we call them, missionaries.
Okay, good.
Oh, of course.
I'm a little tired, but I'm staying with you.
No, God, missionary is a great
right.
office of God. They're spectacular. What?
I went to Jamaica. I was married to a crackhead rude boy. And
that sounds like an interesting story.
It is.
And a long one.
And he got saved.
And a miraculous one.
He was saved. And speaking in tongues. And he ran the streets. And I went over in a missionary journey business. And that's what the rest is in his life story.
God's love prevailed. Any questions about this hierarchy? I put it up there so you could put those four verses together. I just kind of illustrated them and to show you what you're facing. Because these spirits up here are incredibly intelligent. These are probably fallen angels, be my guess.
The prince of the power of the air that was over Persia. That was
right.
The top part there.
Probably up.
The mic had to come down.
Probably up here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it took an archangel sent by God to do it.
But now that he brought that up, notice that Daniel wasn't doing it. Mm-hmm. You notice that?
Daniel was fasting and praying.
Yeah, Daniel is ministering down here. The Holy Ghost took care of that up there. Did you see that in the story? Right, Daniel wasn't there casting demons out of Persia. No, he didn't have that authority. And I don't either. Yeah. So this is what it looks like, but that doesn't mean we have control over that. We do not.
But that's why we have to fast and pray. That's why Jesus said, these come out by fasting and
prayer. Okay, now, she just quoted that verse in Mark and Matthew, fasting and prayer. That's true, but you don't cast these demons out. The Holy Ghost does.
Exactly.
So she fasts and prays, and God answers her fasting and prayer by doing that work for her. But he's not going to do this work here. The person has to have free will and be willing to become a Christian and willing to repent. God's not going to force that person to do it.
Right.
Now, if you pray for somebody that's not saved, the Holy Ghost is fantastic in arranging things to give them a different perspective, and they got saved. Did you hear her?
Yes.
That's not what I'm talking about here. This is a separate subject. What she said was 100% correct. Not in casting these spirits out.
But it's all about having the knowledge through the Holy Spirit of what level of warfare and how to wage it. Because if you lack the knowledge and you're not being taught, then they go around thinking they have the authority to go ahead and command these angels, all of it in heavenly, doing the war going on, everything like that. But you don't. We have to stay within the realm where God has us here and function in that realm through the Holy Spirit to get accomplish what he wants done regards to deliverance.
And then we get beat up. That's why.
Thank you. Okay, we'll go to the next slide then if everybody's okay with this one.
You were
going to
stay
until
8 p.m., right?
Kelly and Joe are staying. All right, now, here is what the churches don't understand, that the spirit realm is as real as the natural world. It's just in a different realm. Okay? And the book of Job is one of the greatest books in all the Bible for science, for the universe, for the spirit world. It is absolutely fantastic. Fantastic. In Job 1 and 2, we get a glimpse behind the curtain on how this whole system works. It's fantastic, right? And the angels are standing before God, presenting themselves, and Satan butts his nose in, he comes in. Remember that?
Right.
Yeah. And then what happened? Well, he says, hey, in the Hebrew, it actually says, God says to Satan, I see you've got your eyes on my servant Job. Okay? He asked him, what you been doing? And he said, I've been going to and fro over the face of the whole earth. And the Lord goes, oh, I see you've been watching my guy. I said, he's a great guy. He loves me, does all these wonderful things. He did it deliberately. Because he knew the devil had picked him out to kill him and destroy everything. So the Lord intercepts it and gives us this divine revelation. And it's spectacular. All these bad things start happening to Job. And it's a nightmare. And Job thinks it's God. Job thinks God's doing it. That's exactly what Christians today think. If things go bad, trials, tribulations, challenges, disappointments, heartaches, sicknesses, they go, why is God doing that to me?
Doesn't the enemy have to get permission from God to even
to do these things to us?
Yeah, yeah, he gave God, the devil, permission
so
to attack you.
So people can then in turn think that God is doing it to them because the enemy.
Well, because they're ignorant. They're ignorant. They don't know what I'm sharing right now. They're ignorant. Yeah. God gave the devil permission to kick your face in the law of sowing and reaping. So if you go out and you, of your own free will, and you start sinning and doing all these things, you're going to get your face kicked in. And God is not going to stop it. Because you violated his laws. The gravity law is the same. If you climb on the top of this building and you backflip off, you're going to be dead. Why? Because you violated the law of gravity. That's God's law. Okay? You're not going to do that, so you're fine. And you're not going to go out and start sinning. You're fine. What God was showing us here is that what people think is God doing something is actually the enemy doing it. And here's what he did. He slaughtered Job's assets, and he even controlled the weather. Most people don't believe he can control the weather. Look at that. He sent a tornado and killed Job's kids. You following this?
Yes.
So people say in the insurance business, the tornado wiped out the neighborhood. That was an act of God. It's actually the opposite. God doesn't go around killing people and destroying them. He wants to save them, not kill them, for crying out loud. And then it happened in chapter 2, remember? And it said the same thing. Hey, he only serves you because, hey, look at him. He's healthy as he can be. He's got all this money. You give him everything. He hit the lottery. You bless everything he does. And okay, let's check it out. He takes his hands off him, but he says you cannot kill him. You with me?
Yes.
So this is all done in God's permissive will. And he does what to him? He causes sicknesses, which is what the devil does. He's able to cause sicknesses. Is every sickness caused by Satan? No, but some sicknesses are. And you as a minister helping people, which is what you are, you are to use your discernment and figure out which is which. Right? What's a burning ulcer? A sheen in Hebrew is a burning ulcer. He had them all over his body, even here.
Everywhere.
Here. Ow. Okay. Ladies, you're not fully getting this, but as a male, having boiling ulcers here, whatever I got to do to get rid of that, I'm going to repent of.
Man, come on.
Immediately. All right. Now, most churches will get in a fight with you. It's already started. Come out in Jesus' name. All across the United States, the churches are now swinging at each other with haymakers. These guys are saying, nope, Christians can't have demons. You can't have a demon where the Holy Spirit is. And the other ones are saying, no, you can't have demons. Let me explain that to you so it makes sense. <It's good. laughs> All right. Christians cannot be possessed by demons, okay? Because human beings are made of five parts: body, soul, spirit, conscience, and mind. Okay? Your spirit man has the Holy Ghost as a born-again Christian, and the demons can't get in there, therefore you cannot be possessed. But your body can have spirits in it, causing a physical or mental illness. Your body can have a demon.
Can you say that?
Okay? So the word possession you should never use, because as soon as you mention that term, everybody thinks of Linda Blair and pea soup. That's all they think of, Linda. And she was possessed. Okay, they were fooling around the Ouija board. Okay, that'll do it to you. Christians cannot be possessed because they have the Holy Spirit living in their spirit man. but they can be infected. So I use the term infected, which people tend to understand better because it's like medical. You're infected. See, you're infected with the flu, but you yourself are not the flu. You're not possessed by the flu, you're infected. When the flu is gone, you're not sick anymore. When the spirits are out, you're not ill anymore. Correct? So possessed is a very bad term. It triggers people. It triggers them. And so they're fighting all over the country about Christians being possessed. Okay, and that's not what we're saying. We're saying they can be infected but not possessed. And they don't understand that. All they're doing is yelling at us. Okay?
And that's probably
and
the influence of Satan to get Christians to fight.
Of course, he created the whole thing, obviously. Brilliant. Now, if I was you, I would write these scriptures down because these scriptures are the ones to use showing that Christians can be infected. Because while they're swinging at you, they're going to ask you, where does it say in the Bible a Christian can have a demon? And they'll take a swing at it. Well, you duck it, you slip it. These scriptures here indicate that Christians can be infected or oppressed by demons. Oppression is different. Oppression comes from the outside. All Christians, from the moment of their death, have oppression. Everybody gets oppressed. There's no exceptions. Okay? That doesn't have anything to do with what I'm talking about. Everybody is oppressed. If you're not being oppressed, you're probably a useless, worthless Christian. The devil comes after people who are a threat to him. So if you're getting temptations and trial, good for you, there's a reason for it. Okay, but you're not possessed by demons. Now, these scriptures will help you get over that fight. There's seven of them. So, if I was you, I would keep these. Yes, ma'am. Oh, if I was you, I'd keep these handy because they're really helpful. Okay. For example, Brother James said that a Christian can have demonic wisdom. He specifically said it right there.
Is that what James is talking about?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
A Christian can have demonic wisdom. Well, that's obvious. I mean, the devil controls Christians 90% of the time through their mind. Okay, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. The God of this world, remember the verse? Yeah. Controls people's thoughts. So here's how it works. You're sitting there minding your own business and a spirit puts a thought in your mind. You remember when your mother yelled at you? The thought just comes right in. Okay. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, you are to take that thought captive, okay? When I was living in sin, I got all kinds of lust thoughts. I had a lust demon in my eyes. So I would stare at every woman at the mall, and I would check out their bootylicious. I would check out bumps. I would look at everything, their feet. It was a lust demon. I was lusting constantly. And the thoughts coming into my mind, oh, that's a hot babe. This thought, oh, I wonder what she's like in bed. Oh, I wonder what her breasts look like. Oh, I wonder what her nipples are like. These thoughts would come into my mind. I never took any of them captive because I was encouraging him. I was living in sin looking for a hot babe. Okay? Then, as a Christian in the Assembly of God religion, which is where I came out of, I was there for years. I had these lust problems I couldn't get rid of. And I went to every minister I could possibly get my hands on. They were good people. I went to the evangelists. I went to the pastors. They all told me the same thing. Read your Bible. Go to church more. Read your Bible more. Pray more. go to the men's retreat. Go, I did all that stuff. I went all over there. And then I would beat this thing down for a while. And then it would flare back up. And then I'd beat the thing down a while, pray through for a while, right? Fast it out, go to the men's meetings, go to the seminar. I'd be okay for a while. Then, boop, this thing would come back on me. And I got so sick of it, I was ready to backslide. I felt guilt and shame. I was condemning myself. How can you minister at the Assembly of God Church? You're in charge of the men's group. And you're having these lust problems. You got bootylicious. What's wrong with you? You're sick. You're nuts. All these thoughts pouring into my head about I was a rotten person. I was a bad Christian. You ought to go back to happy hour. It was an avalanche of thoughts coming to my mind. I had no idea those were demons pumping thoughts in my mind. I did not know they had that ability to do that. Because they don't teach this stuff at the Assembly of God religion that I came out of. They don't teach any of this stuff. I didn't know it was a spirit. I didn't know I had lust spirits. And after I went through deliverance in 2004,
amen.
Healed.
Thank you, Jesus.
And then I started doing it. Working with guys, counseling people, porn addicts, sex addicts.
Okay,
so they started getting delivered. But I realized it was a lust spirit, it was a root of it, and it was the lust thoughts coming to my mind. Hey, look at her booty. Hey, look at her breasts. Look at that. Yeah.
Okay. I didn't have a lust demon, per se. I had a spirit of low self-esteem. I had a spirit of emotional problems because we grew up in a house of witchcraft. And a lot of times it followed me. And that's a long story that I won't go into. And so I had all these thoughts of my dad tried to kill us. And I went to psychiatrists and I filled the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, getting, praying for people, and they got delivered. Praying for people, and their money came. And yet, and still, when I go home, I, you know, be in church and I'll, hallelujah, glory to God, and be happy. And then go home, and then the tormentors would come. So I said, well, and then I go to psychiatrists, I go to different pastors, and they tell me different things, and it didn't work. So what I did, I didn't have deliverance per se. I got into the Word, and I started taking all those things captive. All of those thoughts that came in, I started delivering myself with the Word of God, because everybody I went to, they told me to have something different. But my mind is healed today.
Amen.
Through the Word of God. Through the power of God. And I love myself. I love myself. I hated myself because I came through so much crap growing up.
Yeah.
And I just the Word just goes into my mind. And I every time some thought comes, a crazy thought, I take it captive with the Word of God. And I just say, Lord, I thank you.
And where do the thoughts come from?
Which ones?
Where do the thoughts come from?
Which ones?
The one you're talking about.
The bad thoughts?
Yeah.
The oppression of the enemy.
From who?
From the devil.
They came from a spirit.
Yeah, absolutely, from a spirit. Yeah.
There you
thank
go.
You. See? But I'm just saying I'm free now.
Hallelujah.
By the Word, the power of God. I'm free by the power of the Word. Thank you.
She just proved everything I said. They're putting thoughts in your mind.
Exactly.
They're not real thoughts. They're lies.
Yes.
They're ugly. They're filthy. They're whatever. They're whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? They're not supposed to be in there.
That's
right.
Amen.
Okay? Amen. And if you leave them in there, you'll live a yo-yo Christian life like I did, up for a while, and then I tank.
Right.
Then I'd be up for a while, then I would tank again. Okay?
Yes, thank God.
Ignorance is not something you can tolerate in the spirit world. You don't get a pass for being ignorant.
Amen.
You
Amen.
Get in bondage. Okay? Ignorance is bondage.
Amen.
All right. Now, these scriptures will help you understand how Christians can be infected with spirits. They're really handy. If I was you, I'd keep them. In your little deliverance book, assuming you have one. Okay? All right. Okay.
Could we have that other page for just a second?
This one?
We're on it long enough.
No,
to
this one.
This one?
No, the second page.
That one?
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. Yep.
Question, Becky. So, you talk about how Christians naturally we face oppression and
how they differentiate.
How they did what?
How we experience oppression.
Oppression, Christians. Yeah.
How do you differentiate between experiencing oppression to knowing that you need to be delivered from something?
Well, the oppression spirits are on the outside. And the ones you need deliverance from are inside. And there'll be symptoms.
I guess.
You'll have symptoms. So if you have a fear spirit, they usually hang around here in your tummy or your chest there, right in this area right here. And when you're triggered by something, you can kind of sense them tensing up or moving. And you'll feel a tightness in there or like a butterfly. Like that, your throat get a little tight. People who have panic attacks start manifesting. They get sweaty palms. They choke a little bit here. That's the spirit moving. Those are the symptoms of being infected.
They're on the outside.
They're on the inside. Those are on the inside. You can feel them moving in your body.
So the spirit doesn't give, a Christian does not give.
The spirit man doesn't have any demons.
But it's
your body.
I'm understanding that the flesh of that Christian.
The body, this thing.
Does get possessed.
It's infected. I use infected. Don't use that term possessed because that's going to start an argument.
No. I was trying to understand. So
well, infection is better. Because that it's easy.
It's not the devil, it's the spirit itself.
The spirit, it gets inside your body, and that's an infection. But you're not possessed. Right? You follow me? If you have the flu, you're infected with the flu, correct?
Okay,
then when the flu is gone, it's not you're not infected anymore. Yeah. So the woman in Luke 13 had a spirit of infirmity in her body, and she had kyphosis. She was all bent forward. Remember that story?
Yes. Was she a Christian?
Well, she was a follower of Jehovah. I don't know if she's a Christian, but she was all bent over. What happened? The spirit was removed from her body, and she stood up. She had a spirit of infirmity. Those are demons that specialize in illnesses and sicknesses. So she had symptoms of a spirit, which was a physical disability, right? So you can kind of tell what spirit it is by the symptoms he's giving you, correct? A spirit can't give you something they don't have, and neither can the Holy Spirit. You can't get bitterness and anger from the Holy Spirit because he doesn't have it to give.
Amen.
You can't get witchcraft powers from a lust demon.
No.
They give you lust issues, and you got a lust demon, you're laying in bed at night, and suddenly you feel something hovering over you, you feel something playing with your genitals, you feel something, nocturnal orgasm, something weird. Now that's a lust demon most of the time. It's not a sorcery spirit, you know. A demon can't give you anything they don't have to give. The Holy Spirit can only give you the fruit of the Spirit. He cannot give you the lusts of the flesh because he doesn't have it to give. He couldn't give it if he wanted to, which he doesn't. There's no way to give it. He doesn't have it to give.
Brother, why do you think people do not talk about the lust demons that lay on them and come to them at night?
They're embarrassed.
Okay.
People get embarrassed easy.
And it's prevalent.
Are they prevalent? Oh yeah, I hear about them all the time. Yeah. Another one is fear demons. They'll come in at night and you'll get psychologists call sleep paralysis.
Yeah.
And you wake up and you can't move, and you're trying to speak and you can't get the thing out. That's a fear spirit taking you, holding you down. You're trying to get up and won't move. Yeah. The point I'm trying to make is that each spirit, like a human being, is different. Okay? So, I cannot work on an airplane. I don't have any aircraft mechanic skills. I can't do it. I have some information about this, and I'll share it with you. But I don't have any. God can't give you something he doesn't have.
That's right.
Period.
Thank you, Lord. What about people that say they can, you know, I don't know whether they're talking about praying away storms or weather and things like that, but that seems like that goes against, I mean,
I don't know.
You can pray about it, but.
I don't know. I doubt it.
Okay.
I'm not buying it.
Mm. Right, exactly.
All right, how are we doing? Now, the Greek word pneuma is used in the text for spirit, and then I listed the rest of them. You're made out of these five parts, remember? Those are the scriptures. And when you get saved, the only thing saved about you is this part right here, your spirit man. None of this other stuff is saved. All this stuff is renewed over time. As you renew your mind, as you study the word to show yourself approved unto God, as you work out your sanctification, all these things get healed over time. Okay? You don't get born again on Monday and then have no emotional problems of any kind on Tuesday.
That's right.
Your soul is the seat of your emotions, and sometimes souls get scarred or damaged. And he was talking about it earlier, where the trauma comes in, your soul is damaged. But your spirit man is perfect. Because the Holy Spirit moved in here and you are sinless in the eyes of God. So when he looks at you, he looks and sees a reflection of himself right in there. Because you're his child. You're his guy. And he sees himself in you. That's why the demons of rejection, they're the most popular spirits in the United States. Because the devil always sends them to dysfunctional families. And our country's loaded with them now. Well, this rejection demon gets into the kid during periods of trauma and abuse, and they create a fortress in the child's mind of low self-esteem, self-hatred, and self-criticism. And then after they get born again years later, they don't go through deliverance, so the rejection demon is still in their brain while the Holy Spirit's still in their spirit man. And the rejection demon spends all of his time telling the person, God doesn't like you, he doesn't love you, you don't have an anointing, you're stupid, you're ignorant, you're fat, you're ugly, and he goes, laundry lists of stuff running you into the ground constantly. The number one skill of a rejection demon is condemnation. Mm-hmm. Conviction is the best blessing you'll ever have. Conviction comes from love, and it comes from the Holy Ghost. It's a warning system to your conscience. Right here. You have a conscience, and that is the seat of your morality. And you're convicted by the Holy Spirit when you've said or did something wrong by your conscience. If your conscience is seared, the Greek word is katariazo. It means to cauterize. If your conscience is seared, it no longer works. So that stuff that should raise a spiritual red flag inside you, hey, that's not right, stay away from that, don't get involved with that person, don't read that, don't smoke that, don't drink that, doesn't work anymore. And so the person then is doing things and they have no problem with it at all. Their conscience doesn't work anymore. It's seared. Okay? The first time you had sex, felt a little twinge there. Oh, that's the 500th time you whored yourself out. It's just like another thing. No big deal. That's a seared conscience. Okay? That's what we're seeing in our society all over the country. People acting like psychotic maniacs. What's wrong with them? Seared consciences.
How do you come right? against that?
It's all of it has to be fixed by being born again in your spirit and repenting of your sin, renewing your mind and God's word, and deliverance will heal all these things. But instantaneously, your spirit man is perfect. As soon as you're born again, you're in. Your name, Lamb's Book of Life. You're a saint. You're a child of God. You are unconditionally loved. It's like that. Okay? But the rest of the stuff, it's going to take work on your part and your free will to get set completely free. It is as common as anything in the world to have a church scandal in America. Okay, let's take Hillsong. You got lust demons running amok at Hillsong. Okay? But you got a lot of people over there that are good Christians, they're anointed, they have giftings, all kinds of things. That's because your anointing and your fruit of the Spirit come out of your spirit man. Okay? The demons in your body are giving you the lust issues. So you can have a minister who has a nice anointing with lots of gifts fall. And it's as common as anything in the world. There's nothing, it's routine to have a minister collapse. And it's because they don't understand that after you're born again, you got to get the soul wounds healed. You've got to get these spirits out because they will come back to haunt you. That's how it works. In AA and NA, you got a 3% non-user rate. Why? They don't do anything with demons. They don't believe in the spirit world. They got some kind of a weird God thing going on that doesn't work at all. And so everybody relapses. Okay, well, if you've got addiction demons in there, these are lust demons, and you don't get rid of them, I don't care how many meetings you go to. You're going to be struggling the rest of your life, and they are not going to let you go. You with me?
Yes.
And even if you're a born-again Christian, it doesn't matter. The rest of this has to be transformed and renewed over time based on your free will. See? Some Christians get saved on Monday, and by next Monday, they've advanced past 60% of the people at the church. They've still got their first love. Have you ever met a Christian with their first love? They make you sick. They're actually excited about Christ. And the church people bolt from them like Usain Bolt. Oh my God, this guy's not one of us yet. They still got their first love. But 2 months later, oh, they're blended into the system. Now they're sitting there passing gas, ready to go to Wendy's. Okay? This is how the system works. If you see, in the early church, everybody got born again. It was routine there. You need to be healed, boom. You need to be delivered, boom. Everybody, that was a normal thinking pattern back then, 2,000 years ago. It's not now. It's an exceptional thing now. It's an exceptional thing now. Right? Last night at the service, Teen Challenge showed up. I used to be a counselor at Teen Challenge for 2 years. I know all about Teen Challenge. These are tough cases. Yeah. One guy shows up. He's got tendon tear here. He wants me to pray for him to be healed. And while he's talking to me, he's cursing. I need this, you know, damn thing fixed, and this hell and that. And I'm staring at the guy. I said, okay, well, I'll pray for you, but are you born again? Oh, yeah, I'm born again.
Yeah.
Have you repented of your sin? I pray for myself. No problem. I thought, well, yeah, that's what he said, so I'll go ahead. Well, anyway, I prayed for that guy four times. He was not healed. Okay? The next teen challenge guy comes up. I got shot six times. I got bullets here, there, and there. I took one on my ankle. Oh, okay. Have you repented? Have you forgiven your parent? Have you? Well, no, I haven't. I have this problem, that one. Okay, well, we're not going to pray for you. Let's do Matthew 5, okay? Love your enemies, bless those who curse you, pray for those who despitefully use you. Let's go ahead and do that. So he rattled off the list. Are you done? Yeah, I did it. Okay, boop, pray for him. He stood up, broop, healed, walking down back and forth. The guy over there, four times, no healing. The guy thought he was born again and wasn't. So I'm in a bad spot, right? I'm standing in front of everybody, and a guy comes up. I know he's not saved. So now I run a risk here. I got a risk of an altar risk. You know, I don't want to get hit. You're not saved. Well, that can go both ways. You know, they can get really mad. And I took a shot at it. He didn't get mad. Okay, I got away with it. So I said, listen, you need to do some serious spiritual soul searching and get this this guy's not there. Okay? So I let that one go and I went to the other guy. Yeah? So I said that to say this. Some of these healings are not going to work out for you. Don't get discouraged. Just skip that one and go to the next one. You'll get that one. Okay? Last week, I got me a nice healing at Fry's in the bread aisle. And then last Tuesday, I got a nice healing in my house. A refrigerator repairman came over. He got healed. Some people get healed, sometimes they don't.
Isn't there a time also for people to get healed? Like,
no.
Like, God doesn't always heal you when you're wanting to get healed or when... I mean, if you're praying over somebody, maybe it's not their time to be healed. Maybe it's for them to have that for a while.
No. No, there's no time. There's always a reason for it.
Right.
Something's blocking it. Because the Holy Ghost is always ready to go. He's the green light is ready. Mm-hmm. I want you saved and healed instamatically. But if something's blocking it, your job as a minister is to kind of help them, like he said, use your discernment, try and figure out what's going on in there. Okay, so I'll putter around in somebody's soul, see what kind of unforgiveness or bitterness or resentments they've got. Parents are extremely dangerous because in the Bible, that's the only thing that drops a curse on you. Point blank range. If you dishonor your parents, you trashed your mother and dad, you are in deep trouble. Okay, you're looking at a lifetime of broken relationships, rotten finances, depression, nothing going right. Okay, so that's one of the first things I hit. Did you trash your mom? Well, I did, but she did this and that and that. Okay, I didn't ask you that because that doesn't have nothing to do with nothing. I don't care what your mother did. What did you do? I backtalked her, I cursed her out, I yelled at her. Wow. You just pounded four nails in your own coffin.
That's right.
Correct?
That's right.
It's what it says. That's what I got to get them to repent of before I pray for them to be healed.
Yeah.
We got to fix the mom issue. Moms are tough. Correct? They're bad. They're mouthy. They're critical. They're negative. They run you down. They're disappointed in you. They say negative things to you. It doesn't matter what they did. You want to get healed. Your mother doesn't. Now you've got to forgive her. And you've got to fix this with God. And then once that curse gets up, then I go for healing or deliverance. Okay? Yes, sir. What'd she do to you? What'd she do to you?
My daughter, my youngest.
Your daughter what?
My youngest daughter.
What happened?
Well, she has completely disowned me. She's accused me of molesting her. She has accused all of her family, basically the same thing. And on and go. I'm not going to go through all the details. She's been involved in drugs, meth. I guess my question is, I have no problem forgiving her. She's my daughter. That's my daughter.
You love her.
Absolutely. How do I, as a parent, pray over her to keep that curse from coming on her?
Okay. He wants to know how to pray over her daughter. Now, did you see, are you listening to him right now? Mm-hmm. Oh, this is beautiful. This guy loves his daughter enormously, and she betrayed him. Mm-hmm. And he has deep-seated soul wounds over his daughter, okay? And it's damaging him spiritually. And he started crying. Did you see that? Mm-hmm. That was the wound on the soul venting. The heartache, the disappointment, the sadness of that relationship that got severed, which hurt him more than anything. And he's wounded. He's wounded. And that's what God came here to heal for. Wounded. So let's just pray for him, Rand. What's your name, sir?
John.
John, all right. Hey, can you bring me that?
And she's also
that gum. Gum.
Oh, thank you.
Your name, John?
It is.
All right. Now,